Welcome to this lecture on the criticality condition for bare homogeneous nuclear reactors. In this lecture we will derive the time-dependent neutron diffusion equation and its solution in bare homogeneous reactors, and from this derive the criticality condition. At the end we will generalize the criticality condition to other geometries as well. My name is Jan-Henk Leusseman and I work at the Faculty of Applied Sciences of Delft University of Technology in the Netherlands. We start with the one-group time-dependent neutron diffusion equation for the neutron flux phi. In this equation, v is the neutron velocity, d is the diffusion coefficient of the core region, sigma a the absorption cross-section of the core region, and nu sigma f the product of the number of neutrons per fission event multiplied with the macroscopic fission cross-section of the core region. The first term on the right-hand side gives the neutron leakage rate in diffusion theory, the second term the neutron absorption rate, and the third term the neutron production rate due to fission. The resultant of these three terms determine if the neutron flux increases or decreases in time, or remains stationary. To solve this equation, we need boundary conditions. For a bare geometry, this is given in diffusion theory by putting the flux to zero at the linearly extrapolated boundary. Furthermore, because the composition is homogeneous, the flux needs to be symmetric around the center plane as well. The width of the slab is a, and the width of the extrapolated slab is a plus 2 times the linear extrapolation length, one time for the left side of the bare homogeneous reactor and one time for the right-hand side. The extrapolation length is 2/3 times Lambda transport, or 2 times the diffusion coefficient of the core region, as shown in the lower formula. We need also initial conditions, and this implies that the neutron flux should be given at some time t, here indicated with t0. We will use the method of separation of variables to solve for the neutron flux density in the slab. To this end, we split the neutron flux in a term only depending on space, indicated here with the Greek character psi, the blue term in equation 2, and one term only depending on time, indicated here with the capital T. If we insert equation 2 in equation 1, we get the equation at the bottom. Note that the left-hand side only depends on time, while the right-hand side only depends on space. Because both terms should be equal to each other, they must be equal to a constant, which we will indicate with minus lambda as shown in red on the slide. Here the same formula is given again. The solution of the equation for the time-dependent part is just an exponential function with minus lambda times t in the argument of the exponential. It's clear that the value of lambda equal to zero gives a stationary neutron flux. Lambda is called the time eigenvalue of the problem. We will seek for a solution of the space-dependent psi on the next slide. To find the solution for psi, we first rewrite the equation slightly, as shown in equation 2. To solve this equation, we first need to explore the concept of eigenfunctions and eigenvalues for this type of equations, specific for the geometry under consideration. In this case, this is a slab geometry with no reflector and with a homogeneous composition. The Helmholtz equation provides the eigenvalues for the Laplace operator nabla squared, with b the eigenvalue and psi the eigenfunction. This equation we will solve in one dimension on the next slide. This equation gives the Helmholtz equation in one-dimensional slab geometry with the boundary conditions we have. Note there is an infinite number of combinations of eigenfunctions and eigenvalues fulfilling the differential equation and the boundary condition. The solution of the equation is a series of cosine functions and sine functions. In the solution, given in equation 2, we have omitted the sine functions for good reason. As can be seen in the figure on the slide, the sine functions corresponding to even n give a non-symmetric flux distribution, which is not a valid solution for a homogeneous geometry. Despite that we have omitted the sine functions, there are still an infinite number of solutions satisfying the differential equation and the corresponding boundary conditions. These solutions correspond to equation 2 with odd number of n. Now we go back to our original equation for the neutron flux psi. First, we reformulate equation 1 a bit as shown in equation 2, and we see that this equation looks very much like the Helmholtz equation for this geometry, with the blue parts equal to the eigenvalues bn squared on the previous slide. This means we can rewrite equation 2 for each of the eigenfunctions derived on the previous slide if we give an index n to lambda, indicating that each mode can have its own eigenvalue to satisfy the differential equation and the boundary conditions. Comparing this equation with the Helmholtz equation on the previous slide, it's clear that the blue part must be equal to the Buckling eigenvalues from the Helmholtz equation. Here the solution is shown again, together with the solution of the eigenvalue lambda. Equation 2 shows that lambda is made up of factors which depend only either on material properties or on the size of the reactor core. The latter is the Buckling Bn squared with the values shown in equation 1. Because the value of the Buckling increases for increasing number of n, the same must hold for the value of lambda. And because the minus lambda also determines the rate of increase or decrease in time of the neutron flux in the reactor, after sufficiently long time, only the mode with the smallest value of lambda, this is dus lambda 1, will remain. This means that after any distortion of the neutron flux in a reactor, all higher modes will decay quicker than the fundamental mode, and after sufficiently long time, only the fundamental mode with lambda 1 remains. This slide gives the resulting general expression for the solution of the neutron flux density in our bare homogeneous slab reactor. It's made up of cosine functions, each of which will decay or increase in time with the time constant given by the value of lambda corresponding to that mode. If we wait long enough, after a distortion, only the fundamental mode remains, and the buckling corresponding to this mode is called the geometric buckling, and is indicated with the index g, shown in red on the slide. Now it's interesting to derive the criticality condition for this bare slab reactor. To do this, we first derive some additional concepts, of which one is the non-leakage probability. From neutron transport theory, we know that the neutron leakage rate is given by the neutron current integrated over the outer surface of the reactor core. And by means of Gauss divergence theorem, we can rewrite this surface integral as an integral over the volume of the reactor core. Inserting the diffusion approximation for the neutron current, we obtain the expression shown here with the lambda squared operator. In 1D slab geometry, the Laplace operator simplifies to a second-order derivative as shown here, which with the help of the analysis on the previous slides, we can rewrite in terms of the geometric buckling. Now we should realize that neutrons can only be absorbed or leak away, and the non-leakage probability is therefore equal to the probability the neutron will be absorbed. This probability equals the absorption rate divided by the sum of the absorption and leakage rates. This can be rewritten as the volume integrals shown here, which, in case of a homogeneous reactor, simplifies to 1 divided by 1 plus L squared times the geometric buckling squared. Here, L is a neutron diffusion length as shown on the slide. Another concept we have to derive is a multiplication factor of the reactor. In general, the multiplication factor of an infinitely large reactor equals the ratio of the neutron production rate and the neutron absorption rate. For a finite reactor, this becomes the ratio of the production rate and the sum of the absorption and leakage rates. Rewriting the reaction rates and the leakage rate as volume integrals over the reactor core, and using the fact that only the neutron flux is space dependent, we get the final expression for the K-effective of the finite reactor core shown here. The K-effective equals the multiplication factor of an infinitely large reactor with the same composition multiplied by the non-leakage probability derived on the previous slide. Now we have to derive one more concept, which is a neutron lifetime to absorption. And before doing so, we derive first the distance a neutron travels until it is absorbed, and we will do this for an infinitely large reactor. From previous lectures, we know that the distance a neutron travels on average between one event and the other equals 1 divided by the total macroscopic cross-section. This is the mean free path lambda t shown in the figure. If we follow all neutrons until absorption and calculate at each scattering event the survival probability, which is the ratio of the scatter cross-section and the total cross-section, we can derive that the average distance till absorption equals 1 divided by the macroscopic absorption cross-section of the reactor. Here, use is made of a geometrical series as shown on the slide. This result we will use to calculate the neutron lifetime till absorption. If you know the distance a neutron travels till absorption, indicated with lambda A, it's clear that the neutron lifetime till absorption is this distance divided by the neutron velocity. This is valid for an infinitely large reactor core. Similar to the multiplication factor, we can interpret the product of the neutron lifetime and the non-leakage probability as the neutron lifetime till absorption in a finite reactor. Now we go back to the time eigenvalue lambda and its interpretation. Previously we found the general expression for all lambda values as shown in equation 1. If we focus on the lambda value corresponding to that fundamental mode, we get the expression as shown in equation 2. Note that the fundamental mode with lambda 1 is the one remaining after a long period of time, independent of the fact whether the flux is increasing or decreasing in time. Note also that the buckling of the fundamental mode is called the geometric buckling with the index g. After some rearrangement of terms, we get the expression for lambda 1 as shown in equation 3, where we recognize the lifetime to absorption in a finite reactor, L, and the multiplication factor of a finite reactor core, K-effective. This means the lambda eigenvalue of the problem equals the expression as shown in equation 2. Lambda is called the time eigenvalue of the problem and determines the rate at which the reactor power increases or decreases in time. It can also be expressed in what is called the reactor period. This period gives the time needed to let the reactor power increase or decrease with the factor of E, which is approximately 2.7 in value. Here we see the same expression again. Now assume the effective multiplication factor is 1.001 and the neutron lifetime equals 10 to the power minus 4 seconds. Both values are actually quite realistic. However, it's easily seen that the response time in this case is extremely short. The reactor power would increase with a factor of e to the power 10 in just 1 second. There is no mechanical device capable of controlling such a fast excursion. So how can it be that a nuclear reactor can be controlled anyway? The solution to this is what we call delayed neutrons. In a fission event, a very small fraction of the fission neutrons, typically only 0.7%, is emitted only after decay of a fission product. And this delays the emission of these neutrons with about 13 seconds on average. If we now calculate the effective lifetime of fission neutrons, including the small fraction of delayed neutrons, we get actually a very benign behavior of our reactor core. Try the math yourself. Now we can derive the condition at which our reactor is precisely critical. If you look at the expression for the time eigenvalue lambda 1 corresponding to the fundamental mode of the neutron flux density in our reactor core, we see in the term between brackets a factor only depending on reactor size, this is the geometric buckling, and a factor only depending on material properties, this is the blue part between the brackets and is called the material buckling. Obviously, a value of lambda equal to zero corresponds to a stationary flux in our reactor core. And this is the case when the geometric buckling equals the material buckling. This is shown by the red box on the slide. For a bare homogeneous slab reactor, this would translate into the expression on the right-hand side of the red box. To make a reactor critical, one could either adapt the reactor size, for example by making the reactor core smaller or larger, or by modifying the reactor core composition, for example by maneuvering a control rod, by changing the fuel enrichment, or by modifying the moderator to fuel ratio. The criticality condition is valid for other geometries as well. In this table I've given some geometries, together with the geometric buckling for each geometry and a flux profile. Note that this is only valid for bare geometries, so this means no reflector attached to the reactor core. We will finalize this lecture with a series of conclusions. First, the flux in a bare reactor can be split up in a space-dependent part and a time-dependent part. And the Helmholtz equation for the specific geometry provides the spatial eigenfunctions and eigenvalues. Each spatial mode has also a specific time eigenvalue. And after sufficiently long time, only the fundamental mode remains, and this mode determines the final shape and the final time dependence of the neutron flux density in the reactor core. Criticality is obtained when the geometric buckling and the material buckling of the reactor have the same value. Thank you for your attention. And if you have further questions, please visit the websites below.